Well, good morning. Good morning, Grandview. It's so good to see you this morning. It's good to be in a friendly church today. Amen. Amen. Well, let's all stand and just reflect on the amazing grace of God the Father. Amen. Hallelujah.
Meditate on that for just a moment. I was just praying beforehand and kind of going back and forth on, Lord, what do you want me to share today? And there was actually a scripture, just the reference popped into my heart. I don't want to say just my head, but my heart. And so I looked it up, and the reference, I just want to read the scripture for us today. And first, it comes out of the first chapter of Ephesians chapter 1, verse 7. In him we have redemption. We have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace. I just want to encourage us this morning, and you can be seated for just a moment, for just to pause and just to be amazed at the forgiveness that he has provided for every single one of us. It's not because of our good works. It's not because we're better than somebody else, but he initiated it. His redemption was provided for us. He redeemed us because he loves us. And so he tells us a bit by his redeemed us by his blood. That tells us just how valuable we are to him, how precious we are in his sight. And so as we worship the Lord this morning and come in an atmosphere, allow the Holy Spirit to speak to us. We're not here just to gain more information, but allow the Holy Spirit to transform our lives by his presence with us. It's by the demonstration of his grace. He didn't just say he has grace for us. He has mercy for us. He demonstrated it. And so, Lord, right now we just pause in your presence. We ask the Holy Spirit to give us a fresh revelation, a fresh breath of what it is to be redeemed by your love. To realize it was the power of your blood that has redeemed us. The adversary tries as hard as he does, but the redemptive blood of Jesus declares we belong to you. And so we thank you for already demonstrating your grace in our life, and we receive that grace. We thank you for the presence of your Spirit who speaks clearly to us. In these moments when we become so disappointed or confused by our feelings or the circumstances in life, or sometimes just why difficult things are happening, we just ask for the clear voice of the Holy Spirit to teach us today. We ask for the love of Jesus to remind us of just how much you have paid for our redemption, and that we respond with saying, Lord, our lives belong to you. Speak to us and through us to this world and this day. Help us to be the light you called us to be. In Jesus' name, amen. Just ask you, maybe make a note of that verse, Ephesians 1:7, meditate on it the rest of maybe even just today, but just thinking about that, you are redeemed of the Lord. He has already purchased you with his blood. Just tells us how much he loves us, how much he wants to be a part of our lives, and what he's done so that we can be a part of him. And so please meditate on that and allow it to transform and change your thinking as you go through the day. A couple of quick announcements as we proceed on here. I just want to say thank you for everyone that, again, served this last weekend and the demonstration of your heart with the passing of Stacy Meyer and reaching out to the family there and just showing comfort and words of encouragement and then serving, bringing desserts, different things there and helping out. It was a witness to just the love of Jesus that's on the inside of you. So I want to say thank you for that. Thanks for being here, setting your clocks ahead and being here on time today. And thanks for those, we're here at 9 o'clock for prayer. I mean, that's you get double stars getting here on daylight savings time for prayer, but appreciate you being here. And those on Mondays at noon, just your presence here, continue to praying and just seeing what God wants to continue to do in this place. So just want to say thank you for that. Men's brown bag is this week, so Thursday noonish. Guys that want to show up downstairs at the below the basement of the fellowship, basement of the office building for some fellowship time there. Christ-centered conversation. Just bring a snack with you or your food with you, or some of you just bring a cup of coffee with you, whatever. But just come, be a part of that. Next Sunday is Core Sunday, so that's, remember, we just got that started last month. That's March 19th from 10:30 over in the education building, grades 7 through 12. Sixth graders can come if they would like to. Have any questions, you can see Caitlin on that one. So that's next Sunday. And again, the Foursquare Disaster Relief training is coming up. And if you're interested in that, you need to sign up immediately on that one. There is an email that you put down, your email address, and they'll send you some information that you need to look over and be prepared for that. But you do have to be at all three of those sessions to be able to go through the training and be certified for that. But isn't it good that we just need to go through the blood to be saved? I'm so glad the Lord Jesus Christ made salvation easy for us and that it's not a difficult thing. And he wanted us, he made a salvation available to us that we could know him and know the power of that salvation to change the way that we live our lives. And so let's stand and worship the Lord and just be thankful for our salvation today.
So at your feet. I'm humbled by the wonder of your majesty. One thing I know, I find all I need in your unending love, in your unending love.
Never ending, reckless.
So loved that he gave. So right now, as we just continue just for a moment, just ponder the thought that Almighty God loves you. Not whether you feel it or not, not because of experiences in your life, but just the reality of that revelation, that spiritual truth, that God loves you. And there's nothing you can do to prevent him from loving you. So we must eradicate the deception of the adversary who plants the seed of doubt that God loves you. That seed of doubt that God loves others more than you. And so, Lord, we ask for the Holy Spirit to give us a fresh revelation, a deeper spiritual comprehension of your love for our lives. It's not to inflate our opinion of ourselves, but it's actually to get a biblical perspective of your desire to move in our life when the adversary works so hard to erode the revelation of your love for us. So first of all, Lord, we receive your love. We're limited in our understanding. So we pray for a continual growth and revelation of the love of God in our life. Lord, we know that love doesn't stop with just loving us. Jesus, you even said that they would know that we are your disciples because we love one another. We certainly have not perfected that, and oftentimes have fallen short. But Lord, may you help us at this church that we understand what it is to really love. Not something superficial, not something just emotional, but the power of God released in our lives. Give us that opportunity to demonstrate your love to those that are around us. And may your love transform lives, heal bodies, bring peace to people's minds, bring miracles to pass in lives. Not because we've earned it, not even because we've had some super faith, but it's because we trust in the God who loves us and loves through us. Now, in a sense of just reverence right now with the love of God, if you're here today and you say, I've got an area in my life that I need God to move supernaturally, and I want people just to pray with me. We don't even need to know exactly what it is. Just by raising up your hand and say, I need God to move supernaturally in my life in some area, and I want people around you at this moment now to demonstrate the love of God by look with somebody that has a need and pray for that individual. Well, Pastor, how do I know what that need is? Their loving Heavenly Father knows what they have need of. And so we just start to pray, Lord, meet their need, whatever it is. Lord, meet that need supernaturally by your love. Look around. Has anyone got their hand up? I can't see very good with the lights here and just my eyes at this particular moment. But if there's someone that's got their hand up, look around. Maybe look behind you and see if there's someone that is around you that you could reach out and you could extend that love of God that's on the inside of you. And I say, well, Pastor, I don't even know what to pray for. The Bible just says we're supposed to pray one for another. Amen. And so right now, by the power of the love of God that is provided through the redemptive work of Jesus Christ, we just speak life into these individuals. We thank you that you're meeting their needs, that there are, some of them will be instantaneous, and others it is the plan of God that's being revealed to them and unfolded around them. To some, it'll be situations and circumstances. It'll be changed and transformed. But Father, we thank you that you love them and you desire your good to come to pass in their life. You're not the God who forces things to happen, but you're the God that desires to lead us in the paths of righteousness that are a life of blessing and provision and protection along the way in Jesus' name. So Lord, we speak health to their bodies. We thank you that by Jesus' stripes, they have been healed. What a demonstration of your love. We speak, Father God, forgiveness and cleansing over their lives in Jesus' name, that they would receive, dear God, and experience the liberating force of forgiveness and the freedom that is there because of your love that you have provided for us in Jesus' name. Lord, miracles that need to take place and things that need to go on in their life, provision, Father, whatever it is, protection, relief from demonic oppression in their life, broken over their lives, Lord. We speak into their lives in the authority of a loving Heavenly Father that knows what they have need of and has provision for it already in their lives. We just pray in Jesus' name. We join our faith together with theirs, but we join our love together in Jesus' name. And we just speak into their lives and we declare over them. Now, if you're praying for someone and you sense you have a word or something particular that you just need to speak, just quietly, just speak it out to them or pray it over them, whatever it needs to be. Do it in an atmosphere of love and kindness and pray one for another. If you're not close enough to someone, just start to pray for this place, that this will be an atmosphere. There'll be an atmosphere of the Spirit of God to move in love and in power to change people in this day for your goodness and your grace. We declare it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Turn around a couple of people and say, God really loves you. God really, really loves you. God really, really loves you. A couple of people. Look them in the eye. They need to hear it in Jesus' name. We want to have an atmosphere for the Spirit of God to be able to move and to transform and to change people's hearts and lives. And we want you to be a part of that atmosphere. We want you to participate with that move of the Holy Spirit. And for him to be able to touch lives in the service and not only in the service. I was just listening to some historical events of past revivals that took place. And I thought it was interesting, and this would be my heart, that people, 75% of the people, I think it was, that were getting born again during that time, it happened outside of the church, where the believers were just were excited about Jesus. There was a move of God, and it was happening outside of the church. People were being led to the Lord, delivered, healed, and then they were brought to church. Ships that were coming in from out at sea would come in when they would get close to the city where there was revival. People on the ship were starting to sense the presence of God in their lives. And so I'm just believing that if God did that before, he can do it again. And he is doing it because he is a God of love, and he wants to transform and to change our lives. And he wants us to be ready and sensitive to be usable by him. And as your pastor, I want you to know that I want you not only to be taught, but I have to learn also how God is leading us and moving amongst us, and to always be sensitive. And probably in the past, I've always normally would have a sermon prepared, a lesson ready, many times a series that I would have planned out. Nothing wrong with that. Say teaching's good, especially when it's good teaching. But lately, it just seems that the Holy Spirit is moving me out of a comfort zone also. And that's not mean that we don't have good teaching. It doesn't mean that he doesn't give us messages ahead of time. It's just Jesus spoke before they taught us how to put a sermon together. And so we always want to be sensitive to the Holy Spirit along the way. And it's not that he can't speak in a laid out message that's very well crafted. And many people are very gifted and talented along that way. I just never want to spend more time trying to compose a sermon than I am spending time in the presence of the Lord along the way. I don't mean this bad, but I'm not trying to impress you. I'm not trying to convince you. I just want to be obedient to what the Holy Spirit is speaking to me. And so I say that because of late or even in the future here, if it seems like the pastor's just a little off, well, you're just finding that out for one thing, but other is that I'm really trying to be sensitive. Holy Spirit, what do you want to say and do? And sometimes I don't get that until maybe Sunday morning, Saturday night, or maybe even when I walk up to the pulpit. And so I'm not here to present my craft to you. I just want to be able to present the gospel to you. There's a thought that has been rolling on the inside of me this week, I believe, of the Holy Spirit that I want to share with you and then I believe connect with some biblical illustrations that he's given to me. And it wasn't until actually this morning, I had a couple of different, you want to call them sermons, whatever. And I just say, Lord, whatever you want, however you want. Or if you don't want me to do it, I'm okay with that too. I want whatever God wants to do. But I want to speak on an area here. I sense this is the Lord's direction. And may I say, if we preach the word, you ought to be able to get something out of it. Amen. I want to say something at the beginning here, and then I want to look at a couple biblical illustrations a people who took the risk of faith. The risk of faith. We are good Midwesterners. We like things to be done decently and in order. We like that verse, don't we? We like things to be well thought out, planned out ahead of time. And to take the risk of faith starts to get us uncomfortable even right now. We're already thinking, this sermon ain't for me. This is for somebody else. But I pray that today that we all would allow our faith to get a little more risky as we go forward. But before we get to some biblical illustrations of individuals who took the risk of faith, I want to speak about something that is going on, I believe, spiritually in our nation that is undermining our desire to take the risk of faith. And even as Caitlin had mentioned, that we become comfortable in the condition that we are, that we learn to even live in survival mode. And that is the spirit of despair. The spirit of despair. I intentionally use that spirit of despair. I'm not just talking about an emotion. I'm not just talking about a feeling. I am talking about what I sense and I believe is not just even a demonic force, but a ruling force in our country right now of despair. The sense of hopelessness. The sense of discouragement that is imprisoning people in their lifestyles. And we, the church, if we're not careful, that same ruling spirit in our country, in our community, in our culture, will try to get into the church. And that we must be careful that we stir up our faith, that we have, to some people, maybe even what we'd call radical faith. If faith is pleasing to God, I don't know that you can get radical in your faith. You can only get more pleasing in your faith. The Bible says without faith, it's impossible to please God. You must believe that He is. Can you believe that God is too much? Can you have too much faith that God is? And that He's a rewarder of those that diligently seek Him. That's that radical faith, that risky faith that we get into. But God wants us to be together. He wants us. He's revealed throughout Old Testament, New Testament, that He wants us to be a part of His kingdom. He wants us to be a part of His family. He wants us to be a part of His church, His body of which Christ is the part of. He wants us to have a spirit of oneness. The scripture even tells us later in Ephesians that we are supposed to protect the spirit of unity, of oneness, of us coming together. There's one God, one Father, one body, one spirit, that whole oneness. And yet the spirit of despair comes in, and with that sense of hopelessness, we shrink back and we isolate ourselves. We sense there's no hope of moving on, and so we just find kind of a comfortable place to sit and just survive along the way if we're not careful. And I just want to stir us up today that in the natural, people that should be happy, that should be blessed in the way that they live their lives and what we have in our country, still have a sense of despair about them. But when we're together, we're always happier together, and we're always healthier when we're together, even naturally speaking. So we, the body of Christ, I want us to get stirred up and understand that we're not going to be people that are despaired, that we are discouraged, that we're hopeless, but that we're going to stir up our faith on the inside of us. We're going to stir up our trust in what God can do in our lives. We're going to start to believe that with God, all things are possible. We're going to start to read the Bible and believe that God still wants to work the word in our lives today. That we're going to shake off this discouragement and this hopelessness and push on forward to follow after Him. Because when we get discouraged and have a sense of hopelessness in our lives, this despair starts to get a hold. This spirit of despair starts to distort our perspective. We start to isolate ourselves, and we have a distorted perspective of what reality is. A sense of a purpose and protection is lost from us because we're all by ourselves. So as we come alive and we start to understand that in this day, the spirit of despair is not going to have authority over us, but then we start to know how to minister to people around us. We're in America, which most of the world looks at and sees as the place that they would all want to be, they would want to go to because of all that we have here. And yet we see in this place called America, where everybody seems to want to be, suicide rate is on the increase. We see drug addiction, the opioid pandemic that just is killing people is on the increase. We see that minimum wage, my goodness, minimum wage. You know how many hours I used to have to work to be able to just to make minimum, what's called minimum wage right now. And yet, even with the abundance, and I'm not saying that you're not worth it. I'm just saying even with the prosperity that we have as a nation, people still have a sense of hopelessness in their lives. And I want the church, I want this church, I want you as an individual that has come to know Jesus Christ in your life to understand that no matter how bad it gets around you, we can always have hope in God. We can always trust the Lord in our life. And even if things don't change immediately, even if things don't get better within a matter of hours or even days, that we should always have a radical hope, trust in God in our lives, that we can put our trust in Him. This nation has an unquenchable thirst for more, and it's driving them to despair, because no matter how much more they get, whether it's more entertainment, more comfort, more money, more whatever, it still doesn't satisfy them, and they still feel hopeless. But we, the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, we have a message of hope to the world. Not just that when you die, you get to go to heaven, but there's a Holy Spirit that is with us right here in our lives. He will never leave us nor forsake us, and will help us in some of our most hopeless situations. We can still have hope. If Abraham could have hope at 100 years old to have a child, turn to your neighbor and say, there's still hope. There's still hope. There's still hope in our lives. Not about having a kid. Please don't misunderstand. Maybe in your situation, not in mine. But I'm just saying there's still hope in God. And so as I was meditating on this week, the Holy Spirit just seemed to drop these three illustrations into my life. I do not apologize that I don't have it all worked out. I pray that you get out of it what you need. I pray that the Holy Spirit grabs a hold of you in a way that you stir yourself up and realize I've let my faith be contained by the hopeless situation of this world, and that I'm going to stir it up afresh on the inside of me. I'm not going to allow my culture to dictate what the power of God is going to be like in my life. Turn with me, if you would, first of all, to Mark's Gospel, Mark's Gospel chapter 5. I want to talk for a few moments about the woman that was healed of the blood issue. The woman that was healed of the blood issue. I want to talk about, if we have the time here, three individuals that were in deep despair, but they looked to in faith and acted in faith to follow after Jesus, and their lives were transformed and changed. I'm not asking anyone just to survive until you die. I'm not asking anyone just to hold on till Jesus comes. I'm saying we need to be the church that is thriving, that is overcoming, that is facing the gates of hell and saying we're not going to move, but we are going to bust through. That there's going to be breakthrough in our life. Maybe we've had generational curses. Maybe we've had bad decisions. Maybe people have mistreated us, but there's still a God who loves me. There's still a God who said He'll stay with me, and the greater one's still on the inside of me. I'm going to start acting like the Word, and I'm not going to allow the culture of despair to get a hold of my life. I think it's interesting that the word culture comes from really the word cult. And a cult, if you take that word, it basically is saying those things, that which is worshipped or is greatly valued. If we're not careful, we allow what our world around us says is valuable and worships and starts to control our lives, where we need to make sure that we're allowing our heart to trust and worship the Lord in the way that we are living our lives. Mark's Gospel. Let me take me a minute to get there too. Mark chapter 5. Mark chapter 5, oftentimes we talk about with the woman with the issue of blood. Why do we talk to her as the woman with the issue of blood instead of the woman healed of the blood issue? Why is it that we seem to connect more with the negative than we do the positive? Why is it that we connect more with the associate with the despair than the deliverance along the way? We identify her with her problem instead of what Jesus did in her life. You know the scripture here, and we could read quite a bit of this, but it just started me, Mark's Gospel chapter 5, verse 24. If you would, Mark chapter 5, verse 24. Jesus, of course, is going along. Actually, he's on his way over to minister to Jairus' daughter, who Jairus had come. He said, come, lay your hands on my daughter. She's at the point of death, and come and pray for her, and she'll be raised up. But along the way, here in Mark chapter 5, starting at verse 24, and it says, and he went with Jairus, and a great crowd followed him, Jesus, and thronged him, and there was a woman who had a discharge of blood for 12 years. Everyone say 12 years. I don't know how long you've had your problem. I don't know how long you've had your issues. I don't know how long you've been struggling with some area of your life. 12 long years, over a decade, she's struggled. Over a decade, she's been suffering. Over a decade, what do they say? If it takes 30 days just to create a habit, think how many habits have been created in her life because of this discharge, this blood disease, for 12 years. How many adjustments she's had to make, how many places she couldn't go, how much provision she had to make for the just in case. For 12 years, verse 26, and had suffered much under many physicians and had spent all that she had, and was no better, but grew worse. You want a picture of despair? Someone with no hope. Tried all resources available. Gone to everything that mankind had to offer. Spent all the money that she had. And all that she has is hopelessness. Spirit of despair. Why even keep trying? Why even get out of bed in the morning? Why go through another day? Because of her blood issue, this particular disease, it would have isolated her. Again, that spirit of despair tries to isolate people. She would have no support group, no one to be able to encourage her along the way. She could only be around other people who were in a desperate situation like hers. She grew not any better, but grew worse, and now she is without any natural resources. She grew not any, and yet, it says here in verse 27, and she heard the reports about Jesus. She heard about Jesus, and the spark of faith starts to come alive on the inside. She heard about Jesus, not just that he was compassionate, but that he was a miracle worker. She started hearing about Jesus, and hope started to spring up on the inside. I want to encourage you again, church, the power of your testimony, what you're talking about Jesus, what he's done in your life, what you've seen him do in other people's lives. To start talking about this Jesus that will stir hope in people around. There's a spirit of despair that is on the world that is around us, and they need to hear about a Jesus that will bring hope into their lives. Whatever they're in, no matter how long they've been in it, no matter how long it's been a habit, an addiction, no matter how long it's been a disease, no matter how long it's been a problem in their family, Jesus can transform and change their lives. And it needs to be spoken in the church, and it needs to be broken in our lives, that this is not your cross that you have to bear. Jesus bore that cross for you so you could have a testimony of his overcoming power. They overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives till death. He gave you a testimony. Yeah, we've got a cross to bear, but our cross to bear is not sickness. Our cross to bear is not a curse. Our cross to bear is not something that this world is holding us back from and isolating us from the world that is around us. The cross that we have to bear is we need to tell the world about a Jesus who wants to transform and change their lives. That's our significance. That's our purpose. That's our direction in life.
We have a testimony to share. It goes on here, and after suffering many things and giving all of her money to pay for the doctors, she grew worse, but she heard about Jesus and came in behind the crowd and touched his garment. That radical faith that she demonstrated, that risky faith that she came in behind him, touched his garment. Why would she do such a thing? Touch his garment. For she had said, if I touch even his garment, I will be made well. What a testimony. What a declaration. Well, Pastor, what if it didn't happen? Folks, that's what risky faith starts to declare what God's able to do. I know that if I reach into that point where I push through the problem, and we've preached this sermon before, and you've read that scripture before, but I want to stir up again on the inside of us, folks, that there, oftentimes we're crowding just to get close to Jesus, and there's some people that need to be presented to him and need to be brought to him, and the only way it's going to happen is if we tell them about this amazing miracle work Jesus that will transform and change your life. We should have been, the disciples should have been presenting a woman like that to Jesus, but others were just crowding around just to try to be close. Folks, I'm not trying to just fill the church up with people to sit in pews or sit in chairs. I want people to experience Jesus in their lives. It's obvious there's an epidemic of despair in our world that is around us. Let them hear about the Jesus that we know in our hearts and our lives. That there would be a stirring on the inside of us, that like this woman, that she would be able to have faith come alive on the... Faith is a substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. They've got to hear about this Jesus so hope can come alive, so that they can start to see the possibility that the despair, the discouragement, the darkness, the cage that they've been living in for so long that has isolated them and told them that there's no hope, there's no answer, that there's a Jesus that can still transform their life. Hope comes alive, and then they can make steps of faith according to that. But without hope, faith has nothing to step out on. Faith has nothing to work on. I love the Amplified translation as it goes on here. And we read the amazing thing that happened. She said, I will be made whole. And immediately the flow of her blood dried up. And she felt in her body, she felt that she was healed of her disease. This disease. I want you to know that every disease is of the adversary. That there is no disease that is from God. God doesn't put disease on us so that we would go closer to him or have more empathy or sympathy or anything else along the way. This disease, dis-ease, anything that takes away ease in our life, this peace in our life, this blessing of health in our life, it's not of God, and we need to resist it. That she was made healed of her disease, and Jesus perceived in himself that power had gone out of him. Folks, we want to have the power of the Lord Jesus Christ in demonstration in our lives. And we want to have it not just for a thrill for us. We want to have it not just so in our church services it was an exciting thing. We want Jesus to be glorified and magnified and his power to be manifested in our lives. The power of Jesus went out of him, and immediately he turned around in the crowd and said, "Who touched my garment?" And his disciples said to him, "You see the crowd pressing around you, and yet you say, 'Who touched me?'" And he looked around to see who had done it. But the woman, knowing what had happened in her, came in fear and trembling and fell down before him and told him the whole truth. And he said, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of this disease in your life." I want you to know whether it's a physical disease or if there's something that is causing a dis-ease in your life, that Jesus wants to bring deliverance and healing. It needs to start in the church. We need to start to awaken ourselves once again, that it's not just something that we need to learn with, to live with. It's not just something that we try to hide and so other people don't see in our life, so that either they don't think we're not spiritual enough or whatever, but it's time for us to say, this dis-ease has to leave in Jesus. Jesus' name. The power of Jesus is present in my life. Hope is coming alive once again, and I'm stirring it up on the inside, and I'm taking a step of risky faith, and I'm going to start to declare, I'm going to start to decree that in Jesus' name, this thing has to leave me. This thing has to go in Jesus' name. It's not just about my comfort. It's about declaring the power of Christ in my life. The Amplified translation of verse, or excuse me, the Message translation of verse 34, Jesus said to her, "Daughter, you took a risk of faith. Daughter, you took a risk of faith." Maybe you could write that down and ask yourself, when was the last time you took a risk of faith? When was the last time that it was a risky thing that you did in trusting the word? When was the last time that you stepped out when you said, "Well, Pastor, I tried and it didn't work out"? Folks, I want you to know that's one of the things the adversary wants you to do. He wants you to focus on the one time it didn't work out or the last time it didn't work out instead of the word and believing God that it's going to work out. We're going to keep pushing through. We're going to keep believing what God's going to do. God, forgive me for having such little faith in trusting in you. Forgive me, not little in the sense of it's insignificant, but little in its length of time. We like to use the word, yeah, I'll wait, but wait usually has a time limit to it. How long do I have to wait? We don't have that duration of commitment on the inside of us that I'm not going to quit and I'm not going to give. I'll wait until we see this thing comes back. I will be persistent. I will be committed. I'm risky faith. If I'm going to do it, might as well just go ahead and just do it and put ourselves out there and believing what God can do and wants to do in our lives. This woman went and she took the risk of faith, Jesus said, the Message translation. Listen, and now you're healed and whole. Live well, lived blessed, be healed of your plague. What a powerful statement by Jesus. It's already come to pass. She's experienced it in her life. But she no longer was going to have to live in an atmosphere of despair. She was no longer have to be separated from anyone else. Jesus transformed and changed her life. Not because of a word of knowledge where he called out someone is there someone in the room that's got an issue of blood for 12 years? Not because he looked even in her eyes and said, "I perceive that you have faith to be healed." Jesus was just present and was available. And she had faith that stirred on the inside of her to the point where she was going to take the risk of faith. And if I can just touch the hem of his garment, if I can just reach it to that point, I will persist and pursue. And when I touch that hem of his garment, I will be made whole. There was a stirring on the inside of her. There was a commitment on the inside of her that she was going to take that risk of faith. It's easy and comfortable for us to sit in a service and say, if it's God's will, then it's going to come to pass. It's easy in our prayers to be able to pray easy prayers, "Lord, somehow, some way, work it out someday." But she seemed to have this risk that stirred on the inside of her. This spirit of desperation that stirred on the inside of her. And church, if there's anything that we need to counteract the spirit of despair that's in the world, we need the spirit of desperation to come alive in the church. We need to have a spirit of desperation. I've got to stay in contact with Jesus in my life. I've got to be walking in an atmosphere of faith and trust in him in my life. Are you desperate in your life? Or are you just kind of cruising through life? You know, the other day we went on a walk and my grandson was with us and he had his scooter with him. And we were walking, and he was on the scooter, and we came to one of a hill that would downhill slope. And Marilyn grabbed the scooter, and she wanted to go down the hill. You know, it's really easy to go downhill. You have little effort. Just don't fall. Just don't fall. That's all you got to do. But folks, when it comes to going up the hill, and it comes up coming to the bigger the hills, then it has to have some determination. There has to be some persistence along the way. But life is not a downhill thing. Life is something that there are those moments where we have a little relaxation. There's an ease in the battlefield that we go on. But let's be honest, most of life is fighting uphill. Most of life is overcoming obstacles. most of life is because we now are in Christ, is conflict with the culture that is around us, because it is so different than us. And if we're not careful as Christians, we want to be a part of a comfortable church experience instead of realizing that we need to stir up our radical, risky faith to be able to be more like this woman than actually the disciples at this time, and push through whatever the obstacles are, so we've got a fresh testimony of what God can do in our lives. Verse 34, the Amplified translation says it this way. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith, your personal trust and confidence in me." It's obvious we're not going to get through to all three of these individuals today, but I want to stick with this woman for a while here. Your personal trust and confidence in me. Let's break that verse down just a little bit. You see, that's where it comes to the rubber meets the road. Where is your personal trust and confidence at? It's great to come together at a church where we endeavor to preach the word and pray for people and believe God for an atmosphere for the Spirit of God to move. But where is your personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ? When things aren't working out, and in this woman's life, it didn't work out for over a decade. When she would go to doctors and they didn't have the answer. And when she ran out of money, and when she ran out of friends, and when she ran out of natural hope, then there was still Jesus for her to hold on to along the way. She had this personal experience that came alive, that transformed and changed her life. I ask you today, where is your personal confidence at? I'm not opposed to doctors. I'm not opposed to cash. I'm not opposed to things of comfort in this world. I'm just saying that cannot be where our personal connection is. Those are wonderful, the things to have. I would say the majority of the people in this room are more blessed and prosperous than 99% of the world. If you got a car, if you got a house, and you got a job, you're doing them better than most people in the world. I think it's ironic that we have a culture that is so blessed, and the church that is so blessed, and a world that is so lost. We've got so much. Most of us in the room don't know what it is to go to bed hungry at night, like the majority of the world is. But it's okay to be blessed. Tell someone it's okay to be blessed. It's okay to be blessed. I'm just saying, don't have your confidence in the stuff. Have your confidence in the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. And if stuff comes our way, fine. And stuff goes away, that's fine. Jesus is never going to leave us nor forsake us along the way. Here we see where this woman had, Jesus said, because of your personal trust and confidence in me. Here is a real secret to faith, is having a personal confidence in Jesus. It's difficult to have faith if you have no confidence. I don't know if you see the difference there. If you don't have any confidence in me, if I say something, you're not going to have faith that I'm going to fulfill it along the way. If you're a parent in this room, I almost guarantee that you've had your child say to you already, "But you said." And can I amen or a hand raised? And then just as you're coming down, just go ahead and slap them on the way down. But no. But you said. Wow, if we had that kind of faith in the Word of God. But you said. Not in an arrogant way, not in a judgmental way, not in a critical way. But God, you said it in your word. I've got faith that you're going to bring it to pass. I've got confidence that you're going to do it. It's not because I'm going to believe hard enough. It's not going to be because I've confessed it enough. And even though believing is important and confessing is important, it all has to come down to, do I have confidence in the one who said it to bring it to pass? A personal confidence along the way. It says, "Dear daughter, your faith, your personal trust and confidence in me has restored you to health. Go in peace and be permanently healed from your suffering." Be permanently changed. Be permanently changed. Be permanently changed. I don't want people just to come and just get a break for a little bit from whatever the problem is. I don't want people just to be able to come to church and just, it's a nice place to feel comfortable for a little bit, but then I got to go out there in the real world. No, I want a permanent change in your life. A permanent change that only God can do in your life. When I was, I think it was a junior in high school, I had an afro, and they had to give me a permanent, you know, they had to do, got me the fuzzies and everything. Man, I was one bad looking dude right back then. I'll tell you that. You can ask Marilyn. Me and my afro but the problem was that the permanent wasn't permanent. And after a while, it grew out, and then they cut the hair, and then it wasn't curly anymore. So it really wasn't permanent after a while. I want you to know that the work that the Lord Jesus Christ wants to do in our lives, this desperation that needs to come alive on the inside of us, is that He wants to permanently make a change in our lives for the better. Permanently forgive us. Permanently deliver us. Permanently empower us. Permanently stay with us. To make a commitment that only He could fulfill in our lives. But you see, this culture of this world has come and told us that nothing's permanent. Has tried to tell us that it's not going to last. We even heard people that come forward to get saved or see something miraculous move. No, it won't last. I want you to know that whatever God does in your life, He wants it to last in your life. He wants it to be permanent, to be delivered, to be set free. That whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Not just go to heaven when you die, but He said you'll be saved. The word sozo there, that you're healed, you're delivered, you're set free in your life. There's provision, there's protection that's there. There's a permanent work of God that goes on in your life. He didn't tell the children of Israel, go into the promised land temporarily and then come back out. It was supposed to be a permanent move from generation to generation. The covenant that He made with Abraham was not a temporary thing. It was an everlasting covenant that He invited him to be a part of. And the work of the Lord in our life needs to be a permanent thing. I don't know what it is in your life. If it's just religion, if it's just man-made, it's just like that hairdo. It goes away after a while. But when God's working in our lives, folks, it's a permanent work that we can confidently trust in our life. That we can depend upon it. And certainly the adversary will come and he will try to get us to question it. And certainly there's going to be people that are going to come along and try to accuse us. And certainly there's going to be even thoughts that will come to our mind that will try to get us even to doubt it. But we need to make sure that we understand that we are those that are like this woman. That we've got radical faith. We're going to take a risk of faith in following after Jesus. That all of us have areas of your life that need to be transformed and changed in our life. We're all in the process. And whether it's a healing in your body, whether it's a deliverance from habits, I don't know what it is, but none of us are perfect. But we all need to be maturing and being more like Jesus in our lifestyle. And that takes confidence in Him. That takes faith in Him. That takes trust in Him. But we just need to make sure that we don't give up along the way. That we don't give up. There's always hope in our life if we'll trust in Him. That we can experience His delivering power. The despair of this world that slips into the church tells us, just be comfortable where you are. Just be satisfied and content at what you're at right now. Just learn to deal with it and live with it. Maybe go through some counseling or therapy to just kind of be able just to handle where you are instead of experiencing the delivering power of God to take you where He wants you to be. Where is that he wants you to be? A living testimony of his power that has touched your life. That we are constantly experiencing steps in our life of risky faith that pushes back the culture of this world that tells us that there is no hope. That we stir on the inside of us again, that are we bubbling over with the God of all hope's joy on the inside of us? Have I lost my hope in what God can do? Have I come just to be a survivor? Or am I one that is expecting God? His mercies are new every morning. I'm expecting God to do something, to use me someplace, somewhere. I'm just looking for that opportunity. Not only am I going to be like this woman, now I start to become more and more. Please don't misunderstand me. I become more like Jesus now, where the hopeless can come and I've got an answer for their life. It's not a religion. It's not come to church more regular. It's know Jesus more personally. And when you do, then we start to hang out more regular. And there seems then to be that spirit of despair that is broken. And there starts to become this desperation. We want to be more like him. We want to be closer to him. We want to experience him more. And we want the world to experience what we're experiencing in our life also. Stand with me if you would, and just a few, this moment. I just want the Holy Spirit to have the opportunity to speak to every single person in the room. I don't know what you're facing. I don't know whether it's physical, emotional, spiritual, financial. I don't know what it is that has tried to steal away your hope. I don't know what it is that's tried to put you in an atmosphere of despair, of discouragement, where you have, if you could be honest, you say, I just want to be alone. I just want to be isolated from everyone. You see, we think if we just get away, that everything goes away. But it doesn't when it's spiritual. It follows us. So today's a good day just to be able to say, I'm going to stir up my risky faith in Jesus. I'm going to put my confidence and my trust in him like never before. I'm going to defy him publicly. I'm going to defy the enemy. And I'm going to declare Jesus is Lord over every area of my life. I am going to declare that no matter how I feel, no matter what it looks like in my life, no matter what my thoughts have been, I've got new thoughts. They're thoughts of hope that I'm going to have in God. Thoughts that he, with God, all things are possible in my life. My thoughts are not just so that my life gets better or more comfortable or more convenient. It's so his power can be seen in my life so that I can share a testimony to the world around me. It's not just so that my life is easier. I've got more to share about Jesus in my life. And so right now, just reach out your heart, your hands, whatever it might be, and just receive all that the Holy Spirit has for you. Maybe it's a fresh filling in your life. Maybe it's a deliverance. Maybe it's a healing. I want you to know this woman didn't wait for somebody else to pray for her. She didn't wait for somebody else to lay hands on her. She didn't wait for somebody else to have a word of God for her. She just went ahead and said, I believe that I'm going to receive everything that I need in Jesus in my life. And just right now, just receive. Speak to him if you know exactly what it is. Call on the name of the Lord. Whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved, delivered, healed, set free in your life. And new joy and peace comes alive on the inside of you. Just cry out. Go ahead, break that sound barrier in your life. If this woman unashamedly pushed through the crowd, you just go ahead and push on through and say, God, I'm believing in you. I'm trusting in you. I'm expecting you to move. Manifest yourself. It may happen immediately, but as far as I'm concerned, it is a done deal in Jesus' name in my life. So I trust in you. Lord, we receive from you. God, we know that you are a good God, that you know what we have need of even before we ask. We know that you're a loving Heavenly Father, withholds no good thing from us. We know that you said, beloved, you wish that we prosper and be in health even as our soul prospers. So, Lord, may every dimension of our life be blessed now in Jesus' name. Right now, by faith, we receive. We declare with our mouth that we believe that with God, all things are possible in my life. That like this woman, the believing and the confessing came before the healing and the feeling. So, Lord, we trust you. And Father, as a church, we come together as a body of believers, and we agree in Jesus' name as one that spirit of despair, we rebuke it from its influence in this church in Jesus' name. We rebuke it from this presence in this facility. As people would come onto this campus, there is a break. There is a freedom. There is a moment of peace that they experience. And may what you do in this church radiate throughout our community. But we're not just looking for church services. We're looking for Christ to manifest himself through his church. The power of your spirit, Lord. We go into the highways and the byways of this world. Our lives, may Jesus be glorified. And Lord, we do ask for a fresh move of the Holy Spirit, a fresh move of your presence. Lord, we thank you that when we come together, there is a filling, but Lord, we need on a regular daily basis a fresh filling of your Holy Spirit. So thank you. Thank you for that blessing, that daily experience that we have with you. So right now, in Jesus' name, we receive forgiveness. We receive your blessing of the Holy Spirit. And we receive divine direction to go out into this world, share about the good things that God is doing. And with this fresh deliverance from despair, may we look for others that are under that demonic influence and break that power over their lives also. Lead us, reveal your truth to us. Lord, we pray especially for word of knowledge, word of wisdom, discerning of spirits to be in operation. So that as we minister to this world, dear God, that we're very clear and specific in dealing in situations and see wholeness. Thank you, Lord, for this recorded story of this woman, the power of the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, may it be multiplied in our day as we go out as ambassadors of Christ to the world that is around us. May the same power that is in Jesus' name today liberate people that are around us for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. First of all, if you're here today and you don't know Jesus, if you're struggling with your confidence in your salvation, I certainly want to talk with you afterwards. Just immediately come up. The rest of us here today, you're in one of two categories. Either you received something from God, or you are directed to go and share the delivering truth with someone this week. If you've received today, you say, man, Pastor, that message spoke to my heart specifically in this area. I want you to really allow the Spirit of God to make that a spiritual, positive stronghold in your life, because the adversary will come to try to steal away that word. Meditate on what Jesus has done, the truth that he spoke to your heart today. For those of us that say, well, Pastor, it wasn't something specific that hit me, then he wants you to go from this place and look for someone that is in despair this week and to share with them. You know what? We were just at church this Sunday talking about a woman that had an issue of situation. 12 years. You want to hear the story? Everybody wants to hear the story. Tell them the story. And then at the end say, Jesus hasn't changed. He wants to deliver your life also. Finding someone to go out in this place. We are an uncontainable force, the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. So go out and change the people's lives by his power in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. We love you. find someone around you, if you feel led to, you need to pray, you need to talk to, you need to give a word to, give a handshake to, whatever you need to do. Just don't have to leave right away, but look for them and bless them in Jesus' name. God bless you.